in a, at European level, we all know it, we've been facing several waves of water privatization, no water services privatization. It was this liberalization wave in the end of the 90s and 2000s. It was the use of the crisis and the debt as an excuse to privatize water, as Maria just explained. And as we are going to say to see after with the Irish case. And we are also facing some threats coming from trade agreements, no? Some of the monsters that Maria was mentioning. But what we see is that European people have been proving every time that water is trying to be privatized, has proven that they are not going to allow it. And it has organized the biggest, some of the biggest protests that Europe has seen has been around water. Because water is something that really gets to people, and somehow, every time they try, they face a lot of resistance, like in Greece, in Italy, with the Italian referendum, as we have seen many times in Brussels, or in Berlin, or in Madrid. Just an overview of what are the threats and opportunities that we have at the EU level, because I mean, some of them can also be opportunities. We have the upcoming review of the Water Framework Directive, that as you know is the main piece of legislation that manages water at EU level. We have the trade agreements, we have the transposition of the Concession Directive that Thierry was explaining, and we have the Drinking Water Directive, that is the ongoing debate at Brussels now. Let's start with this one. So, you are all familiar with this logo. You remember the European Citizens Initiative. In Lisbon Treaty, they approved a new mechanism to close the gap between EU institutions and people, so citizens can influence the agenda of the European institutions. It's called the European Citizens Initiative, the Water Movement, and Public Services Trade Union, ERTU, Start One, and they collect not only 1 million, that is what you need, they collect 2 million. They were delivered to the European Commission, and they said yes, but they did nothing, no? Like the usual stuff. And what they decided is what they know how to do better, to put everything into a horrible bureaucratic machine so nobody understands anything that is happening and people just forget about it. So their answer was, okay, let's launch a review of the Drinking Water Directive. So they did it, they did a lot of assessment reports, studies, stakeholder meetings, European Commission informal expert groups. Finally, they defined some policy options, and one of them was to force member states to guarantee access to water for everybody, so universal access to water. Okay, it's not a human right to water, but okay, at least it's something. But in the last assessment, one of these consultancies that worked for the European Commission, they did like a whole Excel file full of calculations that nobody understands, and algorithms, and these kind of things. And from all the policy options that were considered, the only one, I don't know if you see at the bottom, I mean, all the policy options have like green faces, happy faces, but one. And which one is this one? The water for all option. So, because it's too expensive, and it wouldn't help so much to improve the well-being of European citizens. So you start at this whole process because you want to give an answer to an ECI that asks for the human right to water to be implemented in the legislation, and at the end of it you have nothing. This the directive is going to go to the Parliament soon, in the coming months. So the European Commission is going to send a first draft, and we need to monitor a bit because there's always something that they can put there, and especially when it comes to the Parliament, we need to again ask that the human right to water is included somewhere in the European legislation. Let's see if it's in the Drinking Water Directive. We have, on the other hand, trade agreements, and there are a few, no? What TTIP is now, whatever it is. We have TISA, we have upcoming bilateral agreements, And we've been focusing a lot on CETA, on the free trade agreement with Canada. And why the European Water Movement was focusing on CETA? Because although during the negotiation, the secret negotiation, the European Commission and the Canadian government were denying that water was being negotiated, when they published the text, Article 1.9, what water? No, so water is there. And there are a few provisions that are quite worrying in the way that they can push water commodification and privatization. There is an article, this article, Article 1.9, that talks about water, water in its natural state. It's not a commodity, but once it's not in its natural state, it falls under the provisions of the agreement. They don't define really well what means the commercial use or water source, so everything is a bit blurry. But the problem is that assuming that water has a commercial use means that water rights are subjected to trade and investment rules under CETA. When we talk about water services, drinking water, sanitation, the European Union took some reservations. They took reservations on market access and national treatment. But what we've seen is that this is not enough to protect water services. And on the other part of the human right to water, sanitation, only Germany has included a reservation on market access. All the other countries just gave away sanitation services and water treatment. And this goes against the concession directive that excluded the sanitation from these processes. The European Commission always claims that by using a horizontal limitation clause, that is a general clause for all what they call public utilities, protects public services. But what we've seen is that this horizontal clause is not enough. There is not a legal definition of what is a public utility in European legislation. These clauses have never been tested in a free trade agreement with a country that actually provides services. Has been tested, used in a bilateral agreements with Peru or with other countries that are not, they don't want to get to the European services market. So let's see with Canada. And other parts of the agreement, like regulatory cooperation or investment protection, can lock in privatization and stop this trend of remunicipalizing water services. That is an increasing trend with more than 200 cities taking back control of water services around the world in the last 20 years. What water public operators tell us is that CETA is going to limit their capacity to operate, because water rights are going to be considered like investments, and also because it limits a lot this new responsibility that public water operators have, like environmentally and to the environment and to other responsibilities. CETA doesn't have a precautionary principle approach and also ignores the unitary nature of the water cycle. There is a good example when we talk about CETA with Slovenia. Slovenia was the first European country that introduced the human right to water into their constitution. That happened last year. And they did it partially because they have a huge problem of water grabbing. Only one company, Heineken, the beer company, owns 60% of the water that is used by the food industry in Slovenia. And they got access to this water by buying local companies that already had water rights. What Slovenia is fearing, and they were fighting a bit inside the council when CETA was going to be approved, is that when these concessions, when these rights are over, if they want to take this water to under the public domain, they are going to face challenges under these investment protection mechanisms. So Slovenia Estonia managed to introduce a paragraph on water in the joint interpretative document that went with CETA, that have no legal entity, but it shows that at least our concerns are not a fantasy of NGOs, happy grassroots and and unions, but I mean European governments share our same fears of the impact of CETA on water. We've been writing letters with our Canadian partners to the council, to the parliament. We have joined the overall coalition, the global coalition against CETA. We have a wonderful guide for activists about CETA and water that is translated in a lot of languages. I'm sure you speak one of them. And we have some copies on the table. I'm not sure if they're over. And they are in our website that we're going to show after at the end. And then we have the Water Framework Directive, you know, this main piece of legislation. It was approved, as Maria showed, on the year 2000, so it's getting a bit old, and it's time for a review. And this is an opportunity and a huge threat. We have several problems with the Water Framework Directive, starting by Article 1, no, where when it says that water is not a commercial product like any other, but doesn't recognize water as a commons or in the way that we would like it to be recognized. And we have this problem, this monster, of Article 9. Maria already spoke about the full cost recovery principle. By this principle, users of water, or consumers, as they prefer to call it, should pay in their bills for production and distribution of services, for treatment and sanitation, and for environmental preservation, also for infrastructure, for all the costs. What's the problem with this article? That it creates more social injustice because it means that you need to increase the price of water, not the water bills. What we believe at the European Water Movement is that that money to secure access to water for all and to secure funds for investment and infrastructure should come from general taxation. So we, from a progressive system of general taxation and not through the water bills.